Great. So this is the final session for today. What we thought originally was to bring all of these great speakers, and thank you very much for speaking today, putting them together one next to the other, and then trying to do some comparative questioning and talk more about policy and how it relates to industry and interests and along those matters. The only one you don't know yet is Dr. Natalie Wisniewski, right? That's a tough one. And I'll introduce Natalie. The reason we brought Natalie here is because Natalie is probably one of the most successful industry awardees. I actually met Natalie probably about 5 years ago when Profusa was just starting out. By the way, Profusa is the company. It was at a very nice house somewhere in San Francisco, overlooking something. It was nice. We're pitching to each other, and it's very interesting. And then Natalie says, well, let me show you my Excel. So she opens up an Excel file, and it's got probably a list of 30 RFAs and RFPs and just a long list. And I want to do this one, and I want to do that one, and I want to do this one. Nothing's changed except the fact that you've won a lot, okay? So, if you want to know how to do it correctly, ask Natalie. So she co-founded Profusa, a company that is developing in vivo biosensors for chronic disease management and professional health, and currently serves as its CTO. Natalie's novel work on tissue integrating sensors expands the paradigm of biocompatibility through a combination of nanotechnology, tissue engineering, flexible electronics, and other related fields. Dr. Wisniewski has led the grants program to raise over $10 million in NIH and DARPA grants, including R1s, SBIR, STTR, DARPA seeding grants. She was also awarded the NIH Transformative Research Award for work on multi-analytes in vivo sensing for mobile health applications. Dr. Wisniewski received her bachelor's in chemical engineering from Purdue and her PhD in biomedical engineering from Duke University. So now that we know everyone, we're going to start. So the first question I'd like to pose the panel, and of course you could take a moment to think about this, is what can industry provide, if at all, that say academics cannot, and your overall view as to all the individuals in this room which represent the industry, what do you want them to bring to you and what can you help them fund or promote? I think we'll start with Mike all the way at the end.
So I think industry, the unique aspect that industry brings to the table is that they have a real vested interest in developing products for overall public health, whether that's for-profit or non-profit, but the reality is they have an interest in bringing products forward to the marketplace. Academics may develop the science and the concepts that underlie those successful products. They may be involved in evaluating those concepts, in identifying potential candidates for products, and in doing some of the testing of those products. But we don't really anticipate, although I guess it's not out of the realm of possibility, that the university system is going to be the ultimate manufacturer, distributor of a product. Another fact that sometimes gets lost is that the government is not going to do that either. NIH is involved in a lot of product development efforts, but in the end, we are never going to be a manufacturer, distributor of that product. We may distribute products that are needed for public health emergencies, and we may stockpile as such, but the reality is we have to rely on industry to really carry it through. The other interesting distinction, I think, is that academics are interested in scientific investigation, and they're interested in a certain degree of success, but they're not necessarily wedded to the success of a specific product. Per se, or a specific type of intervention, and I think that industry comes in with that focus of wanting what they're working on specifically now to be successful, And that gives us an opportunity to work with them to enable them to be as successful as possible. So I think in the long run, the realization of the fruits of all the scientific discovery and scientific activities that we fund is really falls within industry to really pull that off one way or another, and to really come up with the ways to do that in a most economical manner as is feasible to make it as broadly available.
And just as a follow-on to that, and then we'll pass the mic on, in your talk you said something along the lines of, so we have this SBIR program that we have to have, so by law, what can I do? So pulling this innovation forward, how does the SBIR, does the SBIR cover all of it? Are there other mechanisms?
So I think one of the things is that particularly larger companies in general, large companies of any type, but pharmaceutical companies in general, and my apologies if there are any large pharmaceutical companies in the room, is they tend to be quite risk averse in terms of they want to gamble on as sure a thing as possible. In addition, large pharmaceutical companies typically have very well-established franchises that they're not necessarily interested in either cannibalizing or disrupting. And so I think a lot of the real innovation, a lot of the real new conceptual ways of intervening in terms of health and disease are really coming from the biotech community, which places us squarely in the small business. I think that's where the newest ideas can really see get adequate vetting to demonstrate suitability. In the end, if you're quite successful, you may get picked up or taken over by large pharmaceutical companies. It's not that they're completely averse to changing the game, but they're not likely to be the people who are going to instigate or to work towards doing that. But they'll certainly jump on the bandwagon if you show the way.
Great. So how does the NIVIB view the role of industry in developing of medical devices, bioimaging techniques, et cetera?
So I think he had the right answer. that's simply that, industry are the ones with the know-how and the expertise to be able to commercialize the products, right? The academicians aren't going to do it. The government's not going to do it. And so, we rely on them to serve that purpose. And as he stated, I think... there aren't incentives and there aren't the expertise and know-how at the university level to do the translation or the commercialization, right? They're out there for perpetuating knowledge discoveries and those types of things, and likewise most of large industry is risk averse and aren't going to tackle this. So I view the SBIR program as sort of that bridge to bridge that gap to help try to incentivize some academicians and others to take risks and work on early innovation, but then really relying on industry to pull it out from the other end at some point towards commercialization. So I think he said it well.
Mm-hmm. Great. And regarding SBIR versus non-SBIR, in your presentation, you also mentioned non-SBIR programs. Would you suggest companies, industry, try to get funding not necessarily not through the SBIR? In other words, if that SBIR is a fixed pie, could they go for your bioengineering R01? How are they reviewed? Are they reviewed, of course, they're reviewed together with academics, but what are their chances?
Right, so for-profit entities are eligible to apply to any grant mechanism outside of the SBIR. They have trouble competing, I think, with the large research organizations, the academicians, so I don't, typically don't recommend it unless you are partnering with them on an R01 larger grant, but there's certainly other translational mechanisms and programs that we're trying to put in place that will help sort of accomplish the same goals as the SBIR program, but outside of that limited pool of money. Mm-hmm. So it's something that we're looking for, and specifically at the NIBIB, because our mission is technology development, and we want to help accelerate that. And obviously, I'm not sure many people are familiar with the NCATS, the National Center for Accelerating Translational Sciences, but they were established 2 years ago to help facilitate more of these translational programs. They run the clinical translational science program and a few other large networks like that. So there are my point was just that there are other sources outside the SBIR program that are available, mm-hmm. And that people should be thinking broadly because that pool of money is somewhat limited.
Mm-hmm. Great, thanks. Mark, so in your talk, you mentioned that most of the awards you make to for-profit entities. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yep. Right. And you also look for some royalty payments.
Correct.
So in terms, and now I just want to compare the other sources. So you're saying it's venture philanthropy, right?
Yep.
And the purpose is to utilize those funds to do what? Eventually, the royalty side. What is the purpose?
Yeah, so the purpose is to put it right back into the coffers to continue our mission, right? So the mission is to be out of business, to cure MS, for example. And so anything that comes into the society, we would look to put it right back in to further support additional research and just continue the mission.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, now a question maybe to Russell. More of a policy-driven question. So we've got the MS Society awarding funds, taking royalty payments, and reinfusing the money into the various fields. Now, no, I know you're not the representative of Congress or what have you. Why not? Why not try, get some royalty payments from these programs, and maybe instead of $30 billion a year, make it $300 billion a year. Why not? Why yes? On the government side, of course.
I'm trying to figure out how to respond to that.
You're on record.
We think we're blessed to have the funding that we're actually given, and obviously within the government, we're seen as stewards of the public's interest in the public funds, NIH as well as the DOD. There's a very careful process within the military that decides what the priorities are, and in many ways we have to live and abide by that. And so, for example, it's been determined that in my arena, it's a couple $100 million a year to accomplish, this mission space. In terms of returning some of the dollars to further augment and leverage, we do look at that and we do consider, for example, priority vouchers. If we were to fund a company to develop a specific product that we, the military, need, should we insist that we are able to take a piece of that voucher that they may win and sell, mm-hmm. and reinvest that? And we do have ongoing discussions with that. But fundamentally, our business is so challenging, as I've described, that frequently we just say, we're happy if we can get a partner willing to get something over the finish line, and if their just rewards are a priority review voucher that they can sell, are we going to quibble about, well, we deserve 25% of that to reinvest? So I think that's a general response. It is absolutely an ethical issue, and I've had this discussion with my team as to at what level do we really try to dictate these things. I will remind everyone that I guess, from the NIH side, while we in the military do basic science to some degree, it's only out of necessity where I think NIH has a much broader mandate where basic science that could potentially yield breakthroughs is of intrinsic value. Our basic science is really very targeted typically. There's a specific need that we have, and in order to meet that need, we've got to fund a certain level of basic science. And that defines in many ways how we allocate the dollars that we're given. And so I think there are some pretty fundamental differences between the NIH and the DOD. And then the relative level, since we're focused on the military, our pot of money, I see $17 billion.
Since 2010.
Okay.
About 2.73 per year.
Okay, so I would guess within the military.
Well, I can
maybe
give you the exact numbers.
Okay, well, there you go.
There we go. So let's leave just. Okay. These are the numbers. You can, around $500 million per year from DOD. And, oh, sorry, CDC here as well. Not a whole lot. these are the numbers for for-profit organizations. DITRA, about $200 million. USAMRIC, about $180 million. DARPA, $80 million. It's a lot of money. My next question is actually for,
So if I could just,
oh yes, please,
just,
absolutely.
Yeah, the comment I was going to make is that the issue of getting in basically taking an equity stake in investments we make. I think the issue that we would be faced with is the accusation that we would be making decisions based on potential return in terms of return on the investment rather than the return of the improvement in overall public health decisions. And it doesn't matter how transparent that process would be done, there would be a lot of soul-searching on a lot of people's parts and a lot of investigative reporting on a lot of other people's parts. The way I tried to explain it a long time ago during a media interview was, I said, you know, the government invests a lot of money in developing anthrax countermeasures. And he said, shouldn't the government be getting back some equity return on that? And I said, quite frankly, you know, if there's an anthrax outbreak and someone knocks on your door, do you want them to hand you a dividend check or would you rather them hand you an anthrax countermeasure? I said, my job is to make the countermeasure available to the American public. It's not to make money for the American public in addressing pressing public health needs.
By the way, there is an inherent ROI on government investments. A study by the Milken Institute showed that it's exactly $2.3 for every dollar invested. So there is, like I said, an inherent ROI in there. Next question for Natalie. Timelines. So your company, you want to move fast. It takes time. How do you deal with this, with the 8-month or 10-month or even maybe even a year lag between the time you submit and the time you get the award?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. And we try to deal with it by keeping our grants pipeline full, by continually applying and looking forward for additional opportunities. So hopefully, even the one we're applying now, it won't be reviewed. It may be even awarded, if we're lucky enough to get it, in a year. But right now, we're being awarded a grant that we worked on, you know, starting 14 months ago. And so that's the way that we've dealt with it. We also have a very long-term vision as a company. The things that we're doing, they're in vivo monitoring. So we actually don't have a very, very rapid product development cycle, although we would like to, but we have to put every new formulation, every new type of sensor that we are developing, we actually have to put it in vivo in animals and in humans. And that is inherently a slower process than a lot of other kind of innovations. And so we're a little bit more tolerant to the slower funding cycle. I know from being in Silicon Valley, the computer-based innovations, mobile health, that don't have an invasive component to them are able to have very rapid product development cycles, and it would be very hard to float those developments using a lot of grant money. I think we've just been able to maintain our long-term vision for what we're doing with our platform technology.
Mm-hmm. And once again, as a follow-on question, industry is very concerned with confidentiality, and you're doing very highly innovative things on your end. Obviously, you're not concerned. Can you tell the folks why you're not concerned, or if you are, then how do you deal?
Yeah, no, we are concerned, and we do guard the core of our innovation with patents or trade secrets, but there are so many different aspects to what we're doing that are very multidisciplinary that all have to come together and all function. And so we work with our collaborators, many academic collaborators or other company collaborators, on individual aspects. Just experience, a lot of people are overly concerned. And I hope I'm not saying that naively and that 5 years or 10 years from now, I'm not looking back and being like, thinking that I was burnt because we were sharing, but it's the way that we've been able to be productive in our collaborations, because we come to a good understanding with each other and sharing of information, because we can't build off of and learn from and go forward together with our collaborators unless we do have that kind of trust and documentation in place to help protect respective IP. So it does take some finagling, and we can't make every relationship work, but you know, we're selective in developing great collaborative relationships for that reason. But in terms of confidentiality with the funding agencies themselves, we don't have a in-depth concern about that, because there's not the deep level of know-how that is transferred in applying for a grant. There is a little bit of concern about when you write a grant, you're writing
the review process.
Yeah, and for sure there's information that definitely is transferred in the review process that we wish weren't. So we try to be a little guarded and strategic about what we reveal. But in reality, in vivo biosensing is so hard. And so even if we reveal a portion of it, it's like, I would love somebody. I would love somebody to make it work.
So a question to the rest of the panelists. How do you protect the confidentiality? Are you aware this is a concern for industry? Is this discussed?
So I'll certainly add from a DoD perspective. One of the things I hear, and I'm not sure about the accuracy, is the FAR, the Federal Acquisition Regulations, require in some ways an opening of your books to some degree, whereby your competitors could at least get an idea as to what you're working on. Not the specifics, obviously, but that's a concern. And we believe that that keeps people away from working with the DoD, at least. I described the OTA consortium earlier, and one of the advantages of that is you don't have the same requirements, and we believe that will be inherently more attractive, where there's less concern about insights into your company's inner workings.
And regarding the review, so it's, I guess DoD is reviewed maybe internally, but NIH has external reviews or peer review. How do you prevent a reviewer from seeing the confidential, or rather making use of the confidential information?
So I can just comment from the National MS Society's perspective. We take confidentiality very seriously, and so even within the research grant side, all those applications come in with a clear statement about confidentiality. But especially in the commercial funding program that I manage, we take additional measures to protect that. And we know, I think you alluded to it a bit, there's a bit of a balance you have to strike with how much the companies can divulge in terms of structures and giving away things. There's reluctance to do that, but at the same time, that's an integral part of the evaluation. So, we put all of the typical measures in place for guarding confidentiality between companies and the reviewers that we bring in. In addition to that, we have some rather advanced software products that we use that add additional measures to protect the confidentiality. So we do the best we can. That certainly doesn't prevent someone who sees a structure from running off and trying to do something, but it'll catch up with them if they do, hopefully.
Yeah, so there's not much to add other than that we recognize that confidentiality is something that is a major concern, particularly to industry, more so than probably to the academic community in general, and we take it very seriously. In terms of opening up your books, the one thing that I have said before is that my people are not forensic accountants. They really don't have a way of looking. They have to sort of believe what you tell us in general. I'm not sure that much information can be gleaned. I would add, several years ago at an NIH industry roundtable meeting of the discussion of trying to get more industry academic collaborations, this issue of confidentiality came up. And one company, which I won't name them, did mention the fact that they had done an internal investigation analysis because they were concerned about this, and the impression was, since they tended not to file patents on their products until they were getting into phase two, they wanted to actually see how much information that they thought was confidential was actually truly confidential, and they actually had some people try to investigate through web resources and other types of things what information they can discern. And they came to the surprising conclusion that and I was really surprised at this, about 70% of the information they thought was confidential was in fact out there in the public domain, if you knew where to look and if you knew how to interpret what you were reading properly. And so I think we put in a lot of effort. I'm not convinced that it's necessarily things are as confidential as people would like them to be, nor as they need to be. But it is something we take seriously in terms of preventing somebody on a review from doing something. You know, we hope most of the people we bring on board are ethical in terms of their standards of conduct for how they do this, and by and large they take it quite seriously. But I'm sure that there are issues that slip through the cracks.
One of the most common questions we get, or I would say misperceptions, maybe I'm leading the witness right now, but we hear that if you don't know this general or that general in the right places, your chances are zero. Which we know is wrong. Do you want to maybe tell the crowd that is not the case, or rather, what does win awards?
Since you use the term general, I'll say that applies to the military, so maybe NIH has a perspective, but no, absolutely not true. We get cases where a general will, or a company will tell us, this general or that congressman has an interest. And almost universally, I have the backing from my chain of command that yeah, we're going to do an independent assessment, and if there's no value, it doesn't really matter who's squawking about it, we tend not to fund it. Now, there's a flip side to this question as what things are appropriate to increase your odds of getting funding, and that is a case where I believe it is prudent to reach out to the government to have discussions about what you are working on, and again, what that fit might be like between the government needs and what your company can provide. The difference between submitting a cold proposal with no discussion, which probably in most cases may have a minimal chance of getting funded, at least in the DoD side, versus something where you've had the time and the discussions and gotten the feedback, that can really make a huge difference. Now, that may be totally different from the way the NIH does business, which is a much larger scale.
To a large extent, right? And we have the independent peer review process that separates program from, you know, that review, and so there's not really any sort of conflict of interest in that regard. I will say anecdotally, I do get a lot of letters from congressmen who applicants, you know, send to us and think carry some weight, but there's not a whole lot I can do with that letter. You know, it's all pending the review process. So.
But you would encourage folks to talk to you, to reach out, to get some feedback?
Sure. I mean, I think it's, I think that's a part of doing business and just a part of human nature. Obviously, if I'm familiar with the company, you know, it's, you know, probably a better chance I remember what they're working on and can, you know, if you have that interaction, can get a little bit more excited about what they're doing. They can sort of impart that excitement more so than just reading through, you know, thousands of pages of text, which is what we do for the vast majority of what comes in. So I think the human interaction is important. It helps me get to know, again, what you're doing a little bit better, and give me a better impression of what's going on and get a sense of what the company's all about. I mean, again, it's from a piece of paper, it's really hard to tell if this company's on the right track, what their thinking's or what their business strategy is. It's helpful to have the engagement.
Dr. Carrillo, you also approached.
One other aspect I would add, I think, you know, for solicitations, contacting the staff involved with those is very useful in terms of making sure that you have a good understanding of what is really being asked for, so that you're as responsive as possible. The other aspect that I think, although we don't necessarily influence the review, we may be asked by the review group in terms of identifying appropriate reviewers, and this is sometimes always an issue. It's a frequent complaint of people writing proposals that the reviewers did not understand what we were doing, they didn't have the right expertise. And a lot of times that comes because the first time you see the application is when it's the concept is when it's submitted for the review process, Finding reviewers is not a trivial task. The review group typically has to go through about five people just to get one reviewer in terms of eliminating ethical issues, conflicts of interest issues, and just convenience of being able to schedule. And so having more potential reviewers with the appropriate expertise on that Rolodex will give you a better shot at getting a very competent and adequate review. And so discussions with program staff about what exactly your concepts are may be useful in terms of ensuring that the right subject matter expertise is available to contribute.
I could add to that, because I think your opening question to us was, you know, what can industry do for you? And I would say this concept here, you know, make sure you fully understand what the government's looking for. Take the time to reach out and have those conversations, because A, we don't think it's appropriate for you to be spending, in some cases, hundreds of thousands, millions of dollars maybe, to write a proposal that has a slim chance of getting funded. But on the same token, we don't particularly relish the thought of reviewing, you know, 20, 200-page proposals where maybe only one or two of them come close to meeting our requirements. So it's not fair to either side. And so those upfront conversations, and push us, challenge us, ask for the clarification. And we're usually pretty good about really trying to, up to a certain point, ensuring you have a full understanding. And at least on the DoD side, our guidance is pretty simple. Treat everyone equally. Make sure that anyone who has an interest gets the same level of information. What that does, it doesn't mean that we have to provide, that we have to reach out to everyone, but if someone asks us, we try to provide that same level of information and not be exclusive in any way.
Actually, good connection to the question I was just going to ask you. So you mentioned a couple of times that you don't necessarily get the right proposals or proposals you want to try to get funding, or try to fund, excuse me. So if you had infinite dollars, of the proposals you get, how many would you fund percentage-wise? From what I hear, there's a lot that's not relevant. I know NIH gets about 50,000 proposals a year, awards about 9 to 10,000 of those. Same question to the NIH or MS Society. How many would you like to fund? How much good science is out there is basically the question.
Well, I think the short answer is that there's a lot more good science out there than what we have resources to fund, and the number is closer to 100,000 applications. But you're correct in terms of the total number we probably fund. The difficulty in trying to say how much more we can fund is that a lot of the proposals, the resubmissions, that didn't get funded the first time around, so it's unclear if we funded all the good science, how much more would come back in. Those application numbers would probably go down. But clearly we are resource constrained. I think, unfortunately, that's the way we're always going to be, and at least for the foreseeable future, and that's just the way we operate. One other thing I would add to the earlier comment about contacting program staff is that we don't always get it right when we're writing solicitations. We think we know what we're going after, but a lot of times, and particularly from industry is not always necessarily as forthcoming with us in terms of letting us know what we have. Academics have no problems telling us over and over and calling us up and announcing what they're doing. But sometimes those fundamental new concepts, those fundamental opportunities, taking advantage of particular scientific opportunities to try something different, we just don't know about. And so, you know, in particular, when we write a solicitation, if we get a lot of questions asking, hey, I'm doing this, is this in line with what you're asking for? And if we get too many of those where we say, you know, it's not really what we were asking for, but after a while we say, you know, that's a pretty good idea anyway. Maybe we should have written it differently. That's going to inform the next time out. And so those frequent interactions, keeping us abreast of what exactly you're doing, is really the potential to lead to new areas for us to really begin to invest in.
And I would say, from the perspective of fast forward in the commercial funding, so we don't see nearly as much volume. So we are able to engage a more interactive process in the proposals that we see. So when we put out an RFP, sometimes we're the ones that are reaching out to the company if they haven't done so already. We want to know more about them. and help them get positioned to have a competitive application. So we have a tremendous amount of dialogue relative to the number of projects. I think we would see probably 40 or 50% of them are meritorious for funding. So we absolutely could fund more if we had more resources. And in part, that's probably because of our process is really engaged. And as I mentioned earlier during my talk, part of our mission is to get them prepared for the next round of funding if they're not prepared this time. So I think that's why we feel like we could really fund a lot of the opportunities that we ultimately receive for our RFPs.
So it sounded from the question like you were interested in a number.
Yeah.
of a cutoff. And I can't give you an exact number, but just from a historical perspective, in the early 2000s when the NIH budget doubled and we were relatively flush with cash, our success rates were, our funding lines were around between 20 and 25 percentile. And so we were funding roughly a quarter of all the research. I think that's probably, it depends how you define good science or meritorious science, but I think that's probably close. I mean, I think a quarter to a third is probably close of what we would support. Mm-hmm. It could be more. I guess a lot of it depends on how risk averse you want to be and how much risk you want to take, if there are notable issues with the application. But that's when sort of times were good. We were at roughly those levels.
Would you recommend being a reviewer or suggesting yourself as a reviewer to the NIH?
Yes. Yeah. I mean, so absolutely. I mean, as you pointed out, we're constantly looking for reviewers to help us out with the review process, as it's very tricky to put these reviews together. But I think from your point of view, it's beneficial because number one, it gives you insight into the NIH review process, which I think is invaluable. You get to sit through and see how the applications are evaluated, and then that can inform sort of your application process. So I think it's a benefit both ways. It's very important. It's public service as well, so you can feel good about helping out with the public health service.
So speaking of the review process, many DoD programs, BARDA, require a pre-application phase, whereas the NIH receives anywhere between 50 and 100,000 apparently. Is there a special reason why the NIH doesn't do any pre-application phase? Has that ever been discussed?
Yeah, so there are mechanisms for, in essence, doing a pre-application phase. So there have been some instances. For example, we did this in the early years of biodefense using BioShield authorities, where we required people to actually get permission to submit. So they actually had to send a precis of their application. And then we gave them the permission to write the full application and submit it. There were some advantages to that. There's a lot of disadvantages to that. Partly it's a consequence of NIH really wanting to do everything by outside peer review. So they have developed a process, a two-stage outside peer review process. So there are grant mechanisms where you apply with a very shortened five-page precis, and the award is permission to write the full application in the next round. and that's done, that's being experimented in a few institutes looking at that, because the advantage there is that if you think you're going to receive maybe 200 applications, that's an enormous review process where maybe you might only be making 10 awards. That's an enormous amount of work for everyone for very little. So if you can have a pre-selection round done by outside peer review where you're asking reviewers to just review five-page submissions, and you could knock those potential 200 applications down to maybe 40 applications where you'd review and select 10 from that, it's seen as a little more efficient. But the downside to that is it lengthens the timeline for everyone for all of that, and it doubles the amount of work on the review just to give out one set of awards. So there's pros and cons, but people are looking at that as a way, particularly for very well-received and oversubscribed solicitations.
And within the DoD, it's more of a pre-application, full application?
It can vary tremendously. We live and die, like in my group, we live and die by the quality of the contracts we put in place, and my staff are not contracting experts. I have to rely upon a separate group. Mm-hmm. And I believe in the D.C. area, there's about a 20,000, I've heard this number, 20,000 person shortage in qualified contracting officers. And so they tend to move around a lot, you know, get trained up here, jump somewhere else to get some more dollars, move somewhere else. And so many times we're beholden to what they are comfortable and familiar with. So while the regulations could allow a two-tiered process, many times if they've never done that before, they'll say, no, you got to do, you know, got to ask for full-blown proposals. So it can be quite variable. And too often I find that on our side, you know, we're the customer asking the contracting officers to help. We're not insistent enough. You know, we've got to look out for the companies out there writing proposals, and we should be looking for how do we minimize the burden and the time frame required, and we've got to insist with our contracting people. But again, we're not necessarily experts, so if they tell us it's got to be A and B's not going to work, that can be frustrating.
A question for you, Natalie. What is your recipe for success? How do you do it? Besides the great science, of course.
Yes, that's first. Great science, right? But a lot of hard work, and we were really led to figure out how to write good grants out of desperation. We started the company in 2008 when there was a global economic depression and there was no investor money funded flowing at all. And I think the count was like after 86 VC pitches, I stopped giving VC pitches, and none of those actually netted initial seed funds, which we were desperate for. And you know, and I think although it was very frustrating at the time, it has given us a lot of benefit to figure out how to maneuver with grants, and they're totally appropriate for what our company is doing, because we're doing some, we're focused on commercialization, but there's a very heavy technology and science discovery and innovation component to what we were doing. And so there actually is a very good synergy between what were grants and the goals of NIH and DARPA and so on, and what the goals of those organizations are and what we're trying to do to advance the science forward and advance healthcare forward. So I think because of our persistence, I think the persistence and hard work, really, you know, our first grant, we were rejected and we're like, okay, we're gonna resubmit. And we got feedback. We worked a lot with our program officer, anybody in NIH or anybody who had gotten grants or anybody who had been rejected for grants, like we would just try to learn what we could from them and resubmit. And we resubmitted and we didn't get our second grant. And I don't even think we got our next submission. At that time, you could only resubmit once and then you were done. You had to give a full new application. So we did have a learning curve. And for that matter, we're still learning. We learn about different agencies. We're at a different stage of commercialization now, so we have to learn how to orient our grants for the level of that our company's at. So I do think it's a big investment you can reap really big benefits from. We are indebted to NIH and DARPA for getting us off the ground. Like, there would have been no other way at that time. I mean, for years until funding started flowing again. So,
have you pursued equity funding since?
We have. We have. We just closed a $13 million B round in December.
And what role did the non-dilutive side play in your pitch and how you received?
Oh, it was huge. Investors love to see that you know, their money is matched, so to say, with non-dilutive funds. It's great for the founders. It's great for any stockholder, the employees, the investors to have additional funds. And, you know, there's certain restrictions on how you use grant funds that come in. But in general, at least for us, because we do have such a technology, scientific innovation development need, it isn't just commercialization. Like, we have to really work out the science of getting our sensors to work. So it's, you know, it just has made a lot of sense.
Well, I'm sensing there's some questions in the crowd. So we're now going to open to for discussion or questions. So now would be a good time to, if you have a question in your mind, to raise your hand. And, oh, great, yes.
In the biggest picture, in the NIH and innovation, but I question sometimes, and going, probably the reviewers are used to a certain quality, maybe R01 or other, you know, here's a culture. And so you're bringing out of the box thinking into the box. And so I'm just kind of curious what your thoughts are of that. And can you look back now that it has been a number of years and say, oh, damn, we really missed that one because our funnel was too narrow to catch it? You know, is there any kind of perspective like that? And a corollary of that is now that there is VC allowances and tiny little company, and basically I'm the grant writer. And so, you know, I think about, I'm competing with, you know, those people that have teams of very well polished, you know, I think they've got it perfectly and I don't, but I do my best. I'm wondering if you think that concern you to start to lose innovation?
Thoughts?
Just some thoughts in that regard. I mean, I don't think there's any perfect evaluation system. I mean, I think innovation is one of the trickiest ones to pin down in terms of how each reviewer looks at it. But I think, of course, if you look back, there's going to be companies that we didn't fund that go on to be successful. But you know, you look at, you know, the way I look at it is you look at VCs and other types of folks that are doing evaluations, and they don't pick 100% winners all the time. You know, there's inherent. Nobody can look at these things and predict the future. So, you know, I think the NIH has a, you know, reasonable system in place for doing that. Sure, it can skew towards, you know, less risky type of research, but, you know, we're also asked by Congress to show results. And so if we're just funding very, very high risk all the time and only one out of 1,000 are hitting, they're going to question the programs. And so we do have to make sure we balance, at least from my perspective, from the program perspective, not necessarily from the review perspective, but that we're balancing, you know, risky versus sort of less risk, shorter things, so that we have, you know, some positive things to show from the program.
Almost by definition, innovation might be hard to recognize because it is so different.
Right, so...
hard to actually don't have the right kind of cost.
Right. Right, and we have these discussions all the time internally. And somebody put it pretty well the other day that, you know, some reviewers will say, well, if I haven't seen it before, it's innovative. If I've heard of it before, it's not innovative. That would inherently skew everything towards being non-innovative, right? So it is an issue. There's no doubt it's an issue.
So I think, you know, in the same way as I mentioned earlier, large pharmaceutical companies tend to be risk averse. I think in the basic research areas, there's particularly when there's a perception and a very real issue of constrained resources, I think there's also a tendency to be a little more risk averse. You can always easily shoot down almost any proposal. You can find some flaw somewhere if you're really looking hard enough, or you don't even have to make it up. They're always going to be there. On the other hand, that's one of the main reasons why we do solicitations, because we can target certain areas of science that we think are not being taken advantage of, or where we feel that there are emerging scientific opportunities that may be viewed as very risky or very high risk. And so we can target a solicitation so that the reviewers just get that small subset and we'll pick what they think is the best shots in there. The other component is that our ability to offer product development services is a way for us to provide support for very highly risky things that may need a few simple and straightforward kinds of activities to sort of give them some adequate vetting and credibility in terms of moving forward to make them look much more feasible. It's very easy to take a high-risk proposal
a very risky proposal and say, well, you know, this is most likely to fail, and so I'm very reluctant to give this a decent score. We maybe can support that one component, and if it fails, well, then, you know, everybody's going to go away. But if it's successful, they come back in. They can come in with a full proposal, and they've lost that one potential criticism that would be a ding against them. So I think we've tried to address risk by coming up with other ways to support risk and innovation. The last way I would highlight is that, as I mentioned in my talk, we're focused more on regulatory science, because we think this is one of those things that if it doesn't get attended to, it is not something that the companies themselves can necessarily do anything about, but everyone will say this is too risky because of something you have no control over. And so if it's something that you have no control over, well, we can try to figure out a way to actually gain some control and remove that issue from further consideration. So we try to address risk in a number of different ways.
Before we move on, I'd like to just add a little bit. I've been the author of probably 15 different SBIR topics. You know, we got 15 proposals for each one. I've had a chance to think through this, and I'm always amazed by the technological innovation that comes in that I would never have anticipated, and that's wonderful. Too frequently, though, there's not a good alignment between the technology being developed by the company and my specific needs. There's potential matches, but not enough time has been spent addressing the deficiencies that would best meet my needs. And so recognizing truly what the government's looking for and ensuring that there is a logical match, and where there are weak areas, spending the time. So, for example, I'm an entomologist. I look for diagnostic assays to detect malaria and mosquitoes. Cool diagnostic technology coming in, but if I don't see a partnership where they've got someone who can provide infected mosquitoes or have worked with that or understand the dynamics, I frequently am unable to fund truly exciting revolutionary technology that I wish I could, but I see no chance of it meeting my specific needs.
It sounds like what Dr. Wilson is saying is that you can identify the matchmaking within the institution to take that creative, that thing that you're excited about, but then match it with, you know, the insect that can be infected with plasmodium or whatever. But that,
and not to take too much time, but I mentioned the OTA consortium concept, and the real power that I see there is when we see proposals come in, we can help shape them, at least in the DoD, in a way that we were never able to previously, saying, yeah, that's a good 50% solution, but here's the weaknesses. Let's work on this, and we'll work with you to get something that we truly can fund.
Yes. Thank you. Even the last question, there's a lot of emphasis on requirements, solution requirements. But it seems to be a grey area as far as industry is concerned, that we're dancing around this issue because we don't actually know specifically what the requirements are.
You mean requirements of a particular grant mechanism or requirements of a...
What science, what is the solution for the NIH or the Army?
So I'll take it from the Army side. So, for example, getting back to SBIRs, on occasion I have used those just as incentive to spur innovation without any real expectation that I'm going to get anything out of that. And so those can be frequently quite general and leaving a lot of latitude for how you would address what you perceive. I have, on the other side, sometimes been very specific about, I'm looking for this type product to do exactly this, and we try to be specific as to what it has to do. Now, what we don't try to do is describe the technology that we're looking for, which would limit the innovation and all, but we really try to be specific as needed. You know, it must do this, it must be this size, it must be this weight, must run off of batteries, et cetera.
I would just give viewpoint from my viewpoint, NIH opens the door for you to define the problem. We shape the significance of what it is that we're trying to solve. There's a first section of the grant is all on the significance, and you as the author of that grant, you define the significance and convince the reviewers that what you're proposing is in fact solving a significant unmet medical need. And I think that is backed up when you have physician interviews, when you have data on statistics of, you know, how much dollars are spent in the U.S. on that problem, or how is a person's quality of life, you know, will be completely changed by your innovation. And so I think to be able to communicate that significance, I think from my standpoint, it's like the reviewers and NIH itself want to be convinced that you have something that is significant. And I don't feel like there's as much of NIH dictating to me what you feel is significant, other than your choice of special calls, but there's always the omnibus solicitations, which are quite open to submitting any topic.
Right. So, I mean, so the NIH isn't your customer or your market. So we're not going to dictate you what the needs are in most cases. And right. So our philosophy is investigator initiated innovation. And so we leave the door open, as she said, for you to come in with the brilliant ideas, and we'll take a look at them and see what we like to fund, and have expert panels review that. And so, you know, there are some cases where we do specific solicitations and RFAs, and every time we do that, that's done by engaging with the research community and clinicians to find out what the true needs are on the ground, because we're at a 30,000 foot level. We're not experts in everything that's going on in the clinics and with patients, and so we rely on engagement with the community and industry to find those things out. And so basically just relying on you to do that legwork, figure out what your markets are, your customers, and make that pitch for what the needs are and what your solution is.
Yes, the last question, then we'll start summarizing.
Outside of what NIDIA does to devices, what's the role of devices in
as an artificial kind of thing? So the lion's share of what we would fund in terms of devices, I would say, would be diagnostics. That's going to be the major component. As you start to move to other types of devices, it becomes a little more murky in terms of what really is addressing an infectious disease need versus other aspects of the healthcare system, and that's where it gets a little trickier to define sometimes. We've tried to really focus the diagnostics, which can include devices, but can be a much wider array than simply devices. But it's not as large. Diagnostics in general tends to be a small category, and that's just because of the response rate that we see for these sorts of areas. I wish there was more. I wish there was more. I think diagnostics is one area where we could see a lot more innovation that comes in. I mean, we've put a lot of effort into developing multiplex systems, but other ways of doing diagnostics for infectious diseases other than looking for the infectious agent. I can recall when I was both a medical student and a professor teaching medical students that when you presented them with a microscope slide that had an infectious agent, what they always wanted to do was to go up to the highest power and find the organism. And trained as a pathologist, there's a lot of things you can see at low power that can point you in the direction of what is going on. And I think that's where a lot of the future of diagnostics will be, is being able to integrate a lot of different subtle signals that will give us appropriate signatures. That's a much more complicated system, and I don't think we really have the technology to do that yet. But that's an area, I think, where it's ripe for a lot of innovation to come out.
So we'll conclude with one final question for each one of the panelists. One final thought, one best piece of advice for any of our listeners or attendees today. We'll start with Natalie.
Okay. Actually, as I've been sitting here, I've been thinking about the last question you asked me, which was, what's the reason that Perfusa, my company, has been so successful with grants? And I want to leave with a couple more concrete suggestions. And First, on NIH and DOD and organizational communication. So we have made multiple trips to DC over the last 8 years that we've been doing this to meet face-to-face, even when we weren't funded, before we were funded, just to kind of learn what is of interest to the different organizations and to get on their radar and to ask them to keep us on their radar and to ask for people to send us solicitations or things that they think might be appropriate for us. We've also always follow up with our program manager, or even if we're not awarded, especially if we're not awarded, to see what the vibe was in the review panel, and systematically, question by question, go through the comments from the reviewers and try to improve our application, so that we're very proactive in doing that. And I'm always very happy, especially with NIH, that people have been very responsive to always take time with us to go through those questions. And then on a more tactical, the second point is on a more tactical grant writing strategy. We have done many things, like just in the way that we communicate our ideas, have learned a lot about essentially how to spoon feed an idea. So really anybody should be able to pick up the grant and understand it. And maybe not down to the little details, but like your mom should be able to take it and get the general gist of how this is going to be meaningful. And I think initially we were writing like way too scientifically and technically. So that was a big learning for us. Also, collaborators have been important for us. Both we needed them as a company, but also in being successful in some of the grant mechanisms, we emphasize the power of the collaboration. And I think finally, we also have enlisted the help for grant writing to get more. It takes time. There's no way to short circuit it. And so hiring a grant writer on staff, utilizing the expertise of Free Minds, especially like I wish when we were starting out, like we would have kind of enlisted the help of experts rather than slogging through it ourselves. But it actually is helpful at multiple levels for multiple reasons. To enlist help in the process, because it's not an easy process.
Well, I think the point was made. I think we can stop right here. No, I'm kidding, of course. Final thoughts, final...
So I'm totally intrigued, because I would have said almost nearly the exact same thing you said from the totally different perspective from where I said. But to add on that, know your weaknesses. You all know your strengths. But know your weaknesses and make sure you address those. I have seen a myriad of proposals come in where it is very apparent that you have no real interest in addressing my pressing need. You want to leverage my money to move your technology forward in a way that really is not going to be meaningful to me. So I can smell that BS out from a while away, and it's not helpful to you and it's not helpful to me. So if you can really grab my attention, why, and I'm perfectly fine with leveraging for multiple purposes, you know, if there's a technology that my dollars could help it get over the finish line and there really is value to my unique needs, I'm more than happy to play a role in that.
So obviously reiterate all of that and emphasize, from my perspective, the communication component, because for us being the National MS Society, we have a limited focus of what we're looking to accomplish, and we have a limited amount of human resources to address. But there's something like 4,000 companies, small biotechs in the United States alone, so we can't possibly know what else is going on out there that might be relevant to us. And because our process involves a lot of back and forth dialogue, my one take-home message was to please reach out and establish communication and find out. Because even if it's not relevant for us, because of our network, we might be able to help you find a home where what you're talking to us about is relevant, because we hear a lot of it. We hear from a lot of companies. That would be my advice.
Thank you. So I would just say that the NIH just got a $2 billion increase, so you should get your applications in now before the money runs out. In spite of some of the challenges and issues with evaluating and defining innovation, the NIH does truly want to support innovative ideas, and so we do really want to hear from you. Hear are the good ideas, and so I just echo the sentiment to submit your ideas. If you have a concept, write it up in a white paper, send it to me. I'm happy to talk to you further about it and help you through the process. But that's our job, that's our mission, to promote public health and really promote innovative ideas, and so I'm here to help you do that.
So the last piece of advice I would give people is when you're putting together proposals, responses to solicitation, please focus on
targeting the proposal to the audience you're going after. Configuration and layout of an application may be arbitrary, but it is absolutely critical for the particular funding agency. The one thing that's a definite non-starter that happens, and it happens with some regularity, is that someone will have a DOD application that was rejected. They've gone to school on the criticisms and they've addressed them, but they basically sent it to NIH in the format that DOD was asking for. And the NIH reviewers will just look at that and they will assume that you have no clue what's going on because you clearly didn't follow the rules at all. So understanding the audience you're addressing in terms of the way they want the data and the proposals presented is absolutely critical to being to having your proposal adequately reviewed appropriately.
Great. Well, on that positive note, I think we'll conclude the 11th Annual Non-Dilutive Funding Summit. Thank you very much for our panelists, speakers. It was fantastic. And like clockwork, see you here next year.